जस्ट नेक्स्ट टू हैंड देयर इज एन एरो.
इट इज नॉट हियर, देयर इज ओनली प्रेजेंट. मे बी आई विल शिफ्ट टू द लैपटॉप, दैट इज बेटर. आई वाज ऑन द मेन डेस्क, यू नो माय कंप्यूटर, दिस इज अ विंडो 7 ना, सो आई लेट मी शिफ्ट टू द न्यू. जस्ट गिव मी 5.
It doesn't matter, ma'am.
I can't see here, dear. It is present. All right. When I look at the change.
Is there a hand there?
Is hand and then turn on captions. And then okay, present.
I think, ma'am, you need to shift to your laptop then because.
Yeah. Just a minute. I'll log out and go there. Okay.
Sure. क्या साइक.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am, you are.
Do you have any noise or something? No, it's clear.
No, no. Yes.
Okay. All right. Good to see you people.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, good morning.
Good morning, ma'am.
Hi, Divya. Good to see you.
Hey, ma'am. So nice to see you.
How are things with all of you? Good, everybody?
All well, ma'am. How's everything in Delhi, ma'am? Getting
better? Delhi is getting slightly better, but I suppose, you know, it could be better than what it is today. Let's hope that people understand the problem, you know. That's what I mean. If you people hear any noise, let me know.
Sure.
I mean, from my side, I'm okay with it, but I just wanted you people to check if it is all fine.
Ma'am, we'll wait till I think 11, a couple of more minutes. Ma'am.
Sure. No issues.
And then we'll begin.
How many students are there?
Ma'am, in our batch, we have around 34 students
okay.
Who are in their first year of bachelor's in defense and strategic studies.
Uh-huh.
Ma'am, from this academic session, we are going to have masters as well as practitioners.
Okay.
Jain, sir.
Good morning, sir. Good morning.
How many lectures do you people sort of arrange in a month?
Ma'am, we have this Wednesday, I think today is Wednesday. So we have this as part of our Wednesday lecture series.
Okay.
And I think it was started by General Saha, ma'am, who was our director. So that he used to take in the starting days, he used to take few lecture series on insurgency and all. And we picked up from that. And now we every Wednesday we have lecture on various topics, issues related to the papers which we are offering to the students.
I see. Divya, are you writing something?
Yes, ma'am, continue. Writing something for commercial on Israel only. Right. But I'll discuss it later on Iran also. I always wanted to work with you on that. So maybe then.
Yesterday I had a thing on Afghanistan. We had Bernard Rubin and, few people, Amar Sinha, Ambassador Nambiar, you know, both the brothers.
Okay.
The moment Nambiar comes, General Nambiar's name comes, you know, we worked more closely with him. So,
what was
Sorry.
And what was the topic of discussion?
Topic of discussion was how US withdrawal is going to sort of bring in the new regional actors together or not together. So how the peace process is going to move on. There was this lady from Atlantic Council. She is an Afghan working on violence, basically. So we all understand it's like Arab Spring or political transformation that in the research community believe. So same, it's a political process, not a peace process. I don't know, peace is far, far away when we talk about Afghanistan. But if they can create a better, situation, for people to come up with a constructive engagement.
Yes.
I don't know if you remember, Dawood used to come to IDSA and he often used to distinguish between the turban-wearing Afghans and the tie-wearing Afghans.
Yes, now I remember.
No comment on you, Aditya.
Ankit, ma'am.
Ankit, okay, yeah. Sorry.
I think I should mention that RRU, the university, our university is hosting four Afghan scholars.
Oh, okay, very good.
Who are working on issues related to conflicts and all. And two of them have started teaching languages. Who are planning to teach language, Dari and Pashto.
Dari and Pashto.
Yes,
that
ma'am.
Is, you should, since you are, in a way, kind of a school of military affairs, there should be a language cell. I don't know if you have, but that is something which one should have. So you
ma'am,
have some...
That mandate is with the School of Foreign Affairs and they are known for, I think, foreign languages and all. So,
no. Every university, every think tank, they can.
I'm saying that one of the department here in the university deals with the languages, specifically with the language strategic languages, which have strategic importance to us, those languages. So there is one separate school for that.
Okay. Which is completely dedicated to the language?
Yes, ma'am. Foreign affairs, languages, and political international political economy.
No, but would they, those students and faculty, will they be helping the research faculty in terms of providing them the inputs?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, then that's it.
Yes.
That's it. Because we at IDSA, we've been struggling to, we could have the GIS lab, which was very, very useful. And that, I guess, is something which every think tank or, school should have, because the maps are not often put rightly. And that's where, your own people have to do it.
Is this something new for the GIS lab?
Sorry?
Is this something new for the
GIS lab? GIS? No. It's been there since, 2013, 14, we've been there. Arvind Gupta was on Lal Bahadur Shastri chair, that is when we asked, Dhankar, I don't know if you, that is, so he specifically makes all the maps or whatever you want to do in terms of the way we want it to be shown. And often, you know, the maps are not rightly made, and that is what, you know, our own scholars and our people keep projecting it. And I have seen it in many good presentations where the map is not correct, because we often download it from somewhere and it's not. So that actually, you know, pushed us to ensure that, you know, we have the GIS lab. So that, I think, language and GIS lab, these are the two essential aspects of having a authentic research. If we don't have sufficient language experts, then also it becomes, but ultimately everything boils down to the funding. So
I see someone from NMF has also joined. I think deputy director is there from the NMF.
Parmar? No. Oh, he's a director.
Good morning, ma'am. This is Meena Singh Roy. Welcome. I'm Colonel Deepak Joshi. I'm the director IC of SMASL. Your idea regarding having a GIS lab is quite a welcome idea, actually.
Yeah.
And people working on GIS can actually make maps and, you know, even local maps, national maps, whatever. That's a good thing which I think we can follow up. So we carry this this thing idea from you with your permission and try to implement it here. And also a good thing, because mostly the northern part of the Kashmir, mostly hinting, is always shown wrong, or you know, not according to what our perceptions are. So we think can make our own map and, you know, show what we think it is like that. It is our take over it. I think so. We will work on that. Thank you very much, ma'am, for this idea.
Nice to meet you, Colonel Joshi. It's a pleasure. But you know, being from the forces, you understand the importance of right maps. And I think sitting on the right chair, you would ensure that, you know, there is one. It's just that, you know, we felt it, you know, whenever we traveled outside, and that's my experience at IDSA, you know, over the years, then I realized, you know, this was something, and we discussed it with Dr. Arvind Gupta, who was very, very positive, you know, bringing in new dimension to the research. So that actually then, you know, pushed us to employ this person, you know, who has been making our maps since then.
Luckily, I have worked on GIS software, some of them.
Okay.
Definitely, we can. It's a doable thing.
I know. I don't know the cost factor involved, but I'm sure, given the budget that you might have, I'm not aware of the you know, budgetary sort of limitations, but it seems that it should be.
Touch wood, ma'am, of the university does not have any constraints of it, so constraints of ideas on doing that.
Yeah.
That's now holding us. But we'll definitely do something about this.
Uh-huh.
Thanks for the idea, ma'am.
No, it is pleasure, you know, whichever way we can contribute. Ultimately, we are all looking at the interest of the nation. And, you know, when I used to be sitting, you know, next to the Pakistanis and the others, and, you know, somebody shows the wrong map of India, it's very embarrassing. And many times it has happened, the known people, you know, have shown the wrong map, and then you stand up and you have to say, no, this is not the right map. And the often answers you get is the Google provides this to you.
Definitely. Ma'am, we'll get along with today's lecture. I'll hand it over to Divya and
Ankit
on the proceedings from here. Yeah. Right, ma'am, we'll talk afterwards.
Yeah, absolutely.
Ma'am, may I have your permission to begin?
Please.
Good morning, one and all. School of Military Affairs at the Rashtra Raksha University welcomes you all to its Wednesday lecture series. The weekly lecture series focuses on issues related to India's defense as well as its national security, and we try to understand them in perspective from an academic as well as practitioner's viewpoint. Today we are glad to have Dr. Meena Singh with us to give us a lecture on Israel-Palestine conflict, decoding the Indian position. On behalf of SMASL and the Rashtriya Raksha University, I welcome you, ma'am. Israel-Palestine conflict is, I think, one of the oldest running conflict and the most controversial one. And I think it dates back to, I think, 957 BC when King Solomon built the first temple in the Israeli kingdom. Though both Jew and Arab Muslims date their claims back to the land a couple thousand years back. The current political conflict began in, I think, in early 20th century. To this date, we do not see a comprehensive agreement to this old age conflict, and it still exists today. As far as I think India is concerned, both Israel and Palestine hold key prominence in India's external relations. And to know more on this, we have Dr. Meena Singh. Dr. Singh is currently the head of the West and Central Asia Center at the Tilottama Foundation. Prior to that, she was a research fellow and she headed the West Asia Center at the Manohar Parikar Institute of Defense Studies and Analysis. Dr. Roy has published several peer-reviewed articles and papers focused on West Asia and Central Asia. She has also been involved in net assessment reports and strategic gaming on West Asia and Central Asia. Before handing over to you, ma'am, just a couple of housekeeping points. Please mute yourself unless you are speaking. We'll have a talk of around 40-45 minutes talk by Dr. Roy, and it will be followed by a question answer session of next 15 minutes. Now I would like to invite you, ma'am. Floor is yours.
Thank you so much for giving me this opportunity to share my views on the current subject that has been much debated and the best part is that when you are talking to the younger community, it's always a two-way traffic. What I tell and what I also learn from how they react to what I have to share with them. So I've always enjoyed talking to the students, and this is my first interaction with the School of Military Affairs. So I hope whatever understanding I have on the subject through the academic viewpoint and also my experience in the think tank, that is what I would try and sort of deliver in next 45 minutes. I have prepared, PPT, which is, I'd like to share that with you, because when you're talking to the students, it is important, to give them little more details. As the understanding is then better. And I've put a little more text also. I'll leave the thing with the organizer, and the students can then look at how, they can expand on it. Let me just start the... Just a second. Let me just open. This is a...
No issues, ma'am.
Give me 2 seconds to start this. Is my thing visible, the presentation? No.
No, not yet, ma'am.
Not yet. Okay, just a minute. There's some problem here. Just give me 2 seconds, please.
Yes, ma'am, no issues, ma'am.
Just 2 seconds, please.
No issues, ma'am.
Just
Ma'am, we can see your screen now.
Okay. All right. Is it visible now?
Ma'am, it was visible. I think it's gone. Can you reshare?
Just a minute. Something is wrong somewhere. I'm sorry, this
no
technology
issues, no.
Often.
Ma'am, yeah, your presentation is visible. Ma'am, you can just click F5, the presentation will occupy the whole screen.
You said F5, right?
F5, yes, ma'am.
I'm more used to Google Meet and Google Meet, I'm saying, to Zoom, and is this okay? But it isn't.
Ma'am, in the corner there is yes, yeah, that one.
Still, is it okay now?
I think, ma'am, full screen is not visible. Ma'am, you can just click F5 on the keypad and it will be full screen.
F5 I have clicked, but it isn't working.
Ma'am, there's a button F5 at the top.
Yeah, is it okay now?
No, ma'am, it's still, I think, same.
I have clicked it, it's not coming. I don't know what to do. Wait a minute. I'm so sorry. We need to do something about it. I don't know. Normally it should come here. I'll stop my camera then, and so that there's no. Okay.
Ma'am, it's okay if you have camera on. Just maximize it. Just maximize the screen where there is.
It is. I don't know why it's not. Let me call my daughter and see if she can do it. Just a minute.
Ma'am, can you mail me the presentation? I can just present it from here. Can you mail me that?
Wait. Yeah, I can do that.
Yes.
I'll say stop sharing it.
Yes.
I'm so sorry.
Yes, ma'am. No issues, ma'am.
I'll mail it to Divya or to you?
Ma'am, you can mail it to me, A-N-K-I-T.
Wait a minute. Ankit?
Dot K.
Dot K.
At RRU. Dot AC. Dot in.
Just a minute. Ankit, why is something else coming? Just a minute. There's another Ankit Sanya that's coming. Ankit dot
K.
K.
At RRU.
At RRU.
Dot AC. Dot in.
Okay.
Have you sent it?
Yeah. Just a minute, Ankit. I have sent it to you. Just check, please.
Yes, ma'am. Yet to receive, ma'am.
This is such a...
Yes, ma'am. I will receive your presentation.
I should have done it earlier only, I guess. Sincere apology for this.
No issues, ma'am. Are you able to see, ma'am? Are you able to see?
Yes. Yes. I'm.
Ma'am, you can just say change. I will change it.
Okay. Now this is the first. Please come to the first slide. I deliberately changed the, let me start as to why, I changed the title, because you know, normally when we look at the a problem or a war or a conflict, you know, we cannot see that in isolation. That is one. So I thought, you know, we need to look at the basically, you know, the Palestinian-Israeli issue from the point of view of what is happening in the region. Unless, you know, we see what are the, you know, new changes that are taking place in the region, it would be futile to, you know, exactly understand what the problem is. We all know the history, we all know the problems, but I think the few changes, and I call them a paradigm shift in the region today, and unless we know the current, you know, situation that is unfolding in the West Asian region, including the North Africa as well. But from our point of view, I think, you know, this has been a dilemma as to which side to go. And after Prime Minister Modi took charge and, you know, he initiated a very active diplomacy with the Gulf partner and many other changes in the regional and the global context, you know, they do impact on what is happening, you know, between Israel and Palestine. It's not a new problem. And therefore, I thought these are the few issues that I would contextualize basically this particular problem and then, you know, explain it in a better way. So what are the growing? I mean, when we talk about the region, you know, we often understand only one thing. It is uncertainty, conflict, civil wars, and, you know, failed states. So let us see what are the growing uncertainties in the region, how, you know, the regional order is being reshaped today. And that is where, you know, the linkages can be established. And when we try to understand this Israel-Palestine conflict, it is extremely important to see the linkages with the problem. We cannot understand the 11 days war, you know, just by itself. And therefore, you know, it is very important to see, you know, how this has unfolded, why it has unfolded, why at this particular time. So I thought, you know, I would put in that in the context and then try and answer the questions on this. So if we look at India, ultimately, we are all looking at the conflict and how it is impacting India. Now, how is India adapting to many new changes in the region today? What does this mean for India, the conflict, the way it has unfolded? And as a major actor, you know, in the region, should India go beyond existing, you know, cooperation and engagement? There have been major demands, you know, from within and outside also, that India has to play much more assertive and effective role in terms of the you know, its position as a emerging power, you know, which is trying to occupy a certain place in the global order. Now the other factor, you know, which has impacted the region is the COVID-19. It has created new set of challenges, and at the same time, you know, it has brought about many changes, not only in terms of the way we looked at the problem, but also how global economy is going to probably unfold in coming years. And all these factors, you know, will have their impact on all the conflicts, all the issues that we would be looking at. Please change. So if we are looking at the conflict and the uncertainties in the region, then we see following, you know, conflicts, which, you know, need to be looked at, you know, from a very different angle today. These are, you know, pretty old issues, but the way, you know, the problems and the conflicts have taken a new dimension, you know, in terms of how serious they are, whether there could be any way to resolve them, or they can be managed in a better way. So Saudi-Iran confrontation, if we see, you know, back from the history, there are historical reasons. But I would always say, when we are looking at the war, war is extension of politics. That is what is the reality. If we look at the conflict in Syria, whether we are looking at the civil war in Yemen, conflict in Libya, new situation in Lebanon, uncertainties in Iraq, the Israel-Palestine issue, you know, all these uncertainties, you know, they do impact on each other. So the linkages, you know, with the problem is something we need to understand. We need to understand as to how region has evolved in the last 10 to 15 years, and particularly in the last 5 to 6 years. I don't think, you know, we will be able to understand the Israel-Palestinian issue unless we talk about the new dynamics which is unfolding. Next, please. Now, you know, when we, as I said, when we talk about the region, the one question that comes to our mind is the region in turmoil. And that's the normal, you know, perception about the region. But as a researcher, you know, when I look at the region, I feel, you know, it would be unfair on the part of a researcher to actually club the entire region to be in turmoil. That would not be fair from our point of view. This is not to challenge the viewpoint that the region is in problem. There are many challenges. So I would like to categorize this region basically in the three subsections. The first is the comparatively stable countries. Now, when I'm saying comparatively stable countries, I'm not denying the fact that there are no problems and challenges. That would be unfair. So here I would like to put UAE, Iran, Saudi Arabia, Oman, Kuwait, Qatar, Turkey, Israel, Egypt, and Tunisia. Now, as I said, people might often question as to why there are challenges and problems, but you can't compare these countries with the countries which are actually in turmoil, which are also being seen as a failed states, is Syria, Iraq, Yemen, and Libya. And in between, you have Jordan, Lebanon, and Palestine, where you can see the countries are, you know, being in between these two. And this is where, you know, you can see the impact of what is happening in and around. Next, please. Now, when I'm saying there is a new order which is unfolding today, and there are various factors which I will come to them a little later. But let us understand, if we are talking about the new order, what was the old West Asian order and why did it fail? I would say the change is something which is inevitable. You cannot stop the changes. If we look at the old West Asian order, we see the old West Asian order was basically dominated when we look at by the military alliances. Power dynamic was the key factor, you know, pushing this order, and social and economic challenges were overlooked. So the strategic dimension of the issue was much more significant. Military alliances where the power game was played, and this did not deliver the desired result or what they thought could happen. Now, there were many other factors which we would come down, but the old West Asian order, according to me, was basically, you know, dominated by these factors, and therefore they did not deliver the desired result of peace, of coordination, or whatever you may like to call it. Next, please. So when we look at today, the region, I think there is a paradigm shift today in the region, in the regional, order and the changes which are being reflected today. And there has been a constant change. I would say the region has given us major strategic surprises if we look at it. And here, when we look at the new regional power dynamics, I mean, these are a kind of a two blocks, but not in a sense that I would say they are together for certain interests. But this is something which we do see unfolding in the region. We see Saudi Arabia, Israel, UAE, and USA in one column. You know, the other one we see is Iran, Iraq, Syria, and Hezbollah, which are major players. You know that these are, you know, they have some kind of a convergence to come together in this new dynamics that you see. And there has been, you know, cooperation also a very selected cooperation between the two blocks as well, the individual country, you know, when here I can talk about Russia, which has also cooperated in certain areas, but it has more interest and, you know, the areas where it sees contradiction with the other bloc. You have the USA and Europe as one, you know, one side, and then you have Russia on the other side. So, you know, the alignments and the realignments are being shaped and reshaped. And this is what is the new feature as I see it. When you see the regional actors also, whether it is Iran, Turkey, Israel, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, Egypt, you know, we cannot, and including, I would say, even Qatar here, you know, I mean, they have played a very, very significant role. And these are all linked to the Palestinian issue as well. You know, it is not. There have been many changes when we talk about the problem of Israel-Palestine. They have been in the forefront at some stage. Later on, you know, nobody wanted to look at it. It was at the back burner. And suddenly, you know, we saw this conflict. Second, next, please. Here, you know, Iran and Israel have been, you know, a major factor if we look at the last few years, and particularly the Trump administration's changed policy towards the region. Iran's regional strategy are very, very clear. And whether, you know, you like or you don't like, but Iran is one country which you cannot ignore. And its regional strategies defined by its own scholars is something which is here, you know. It resists the US presence, influence in the Persian Gulf. That is what it is doing. And I don't think even after the new, you know, regime, which will come to power very soon, the hardliners, any of these strategies are going to change. It is only the question of how the US-Iran relations will unfold under the Biden administration. But I don't see, unless Iran is accepted by, you know, its the West Asian partners, and they are out of that, you know, syndrome of Iran's increasing influence, which they feel threatened. They are not very confident about how Iran will behave if it becomes a very powerful militarily, if it gets the nuclear weapon. So, and Iran is so isolated that, you know, it will not leave its current strategies so long as we have the present regime continued. And I don't see much change coming up in Iran very soon. It has, you know, I mean, if you look at the other part, it has increased and sustained its regional influence. And that you can see how it got reflected in its connections with Hamas. If you see the missiles, you know, I'm sure some of you must have traveled to Israel. And if you see, they showcase the missiles and you can read the Iranian linkages there. So this is something which will not stop unless Iran is going to actually accept, is going to be accepted as the regional power by, you know, the Arab world as such. All-out confrontation fight with the Takfiri terrorist, you know, groups such as Al-Qaeda, Jabhat al-Nusra, and the IS. So this is something which is, you know, there as a part of Iran's strategy. Act as a counterbalance to the Saudi effort to maintain its influence in the region. The Saudi-Iran confrontation is not likely to, you know, completely go away from the scene, despite the recent backdoor engagement. And I call them selective engagement based on the situation today and the uncertainties which are unfolding in the region, given the major involvement of the Asian actors, as well as the withdrawal of this would have in the future course. Now, confront Israel in the region and resist Israeli occupation and support the Palestinian resistance groups such as Hamas. So this was just not to you know, tell you, but I thought, you know, it is important to understand how Iran is formulating his strategies. Next slide, please. So if I'm saying there is a shaping of new Middle East, then what are the new elements that we can look at? This is the, as I said, there are new alignments and the regional power dynamics. Military adventurism, when we look at Turkey, we do see the new military adventurism in the region and how Turkey wants to play a role. And all this is getting reflected in the in many ways, you know, in what has happened in the region. We also see new arms race today, and this is not going to go away. And this is where the China factor will come in. Developmental diplomacy, if you look at the region and the involvement of, you know, players like China, you know, they are trying to attract these countries, including Israel, I would say, where I call them the new integration game through infrastructural projects and the new energy game. Now, this is something which is a key sort of element of the new order that we could see, or shaping of the new Middle East or the West Asia, North Africa that we are talking about. And this is where the Belt and the Road Initiative comes in. Medical and the healthcare diplomacy is something which is also being part of the new shaping of the engagement that we see today. Role of technology and the usage of soft power, I think, is the new element. I don't think it was as prominent as it used it is today. Increasing public interest and the new social contract, you know, which the countries are trying to offer to their people. And we look at even if we look at, you know, major conflict zones and the increasing, you know, public unrest in various countries, you know, this factor becomes important. Next, please. When we look at this contested regional order, you know, so the key features that we need to understand, and I'm just trying to, you know, flag these points so that when we come to the conflict, we can, you know, correlate certain things of why, you know, this is happening. If we look at the competition between the regional powers rather than external ones for the geopolitical influence has become the defining feature of the regional politics today. This was not the case before. So this is one. And I said region has always surprised us. But I would also say the region has, you know, is also witness to the many strategic mistakes that have happened in past. And hello. I can't see the... what I am trying to say, there are many other features, like, you know, when we look at the contested regional order, the factors which are impacting the whole issue is also the legacy of Trump administration. And now with the Biden administration coming and changing the policy. So there are implications for this. I think the way, you know, international community has reacted to what has happened between Israel and Palestine today, had that been Trump administration, I think the reaction could have been somewhat different. That is what I would say. If we look at some other, you know, features, Russia's re-entry has made a major change in terms of the issues that we are seeing. The US withdrawal from JCPOA and now the new round of talks and its future is something also to be taken into account. As I said, increasing Saudi-Iran confrontation is not going to go away. The Qatar crisis and how it has been resolved later, you know, at the last stages of the efforts that the Trump administration took is one. The emergence of new Saudi-UAE security cooperation, the stronger, you know, elements of the military engagement between two, and their common, stand on the regional issues is something. And I think the Abraham Accord has made a lot of changes there. And then softening of the Saudi policy towards Israel and the beginning of the backdoor diplomacy between Iran and Saudi Arabia. Next, please. these, you know, the other features are, no, next. Next, please. Yeah, I think the rise and fall of the Daesh or the IS is another important feature. Turkey's new regional ambition, then coping with the sectarian ethnic contestations, the technological revolution, the regime security, food and water security have been come on the forefront when we are looking at the region, including what we see, you know, in the Palestinian areas in the Gaza and also the West Bank. I've already talked about the other issues here. One important factor that is shaping the new order in the region is the emergence of the involvement of the Asian countries, and particularly China and India. But I would also say that the region is not without any hope. We do have some, you know, positive elements that there are many opportunities when we talk about UAE, particularly when we talk about, you know, the other Gulf partners also. Next, please. So what are the strategic options for the region? And this is where I think, you know, build stronger alliances with the selected regional partners, strengthen regional security frameworks plus extra regional actors, develop multi-vector policy of engagement, need-based cooperation. This is what we are also seeing, reducing complete dependence on one power and constructive regional engagement based on politico-economic cooperation, which is inclusive. So what is the viable option? The viable option for the region, which is so inflicted with the complicated, you know, problems and civil wars, some kind of an inclusive dialogue is something which will only bring forth some way of managing these issues. If there is in dialogue, and this I've been talking for many years now, and we do see, you know, in between coming of the Saudi Arabia and Iran together. If we see some kind of an engagement between the Iran and Saudi Arabia, lot of issues can be, you know, addressed. Next slide, please. And when I'm saying the regional security dialogue among the partners there, what do I mean by this? When I'm talking about this, what I mean is these dialogues have to be based on the geopolitical realities. You cannot wish away the factor that you need to have, you know, all actors which are important. It has to be an inclusive dialogue and not, you know, a dialogue among the partners who agree among themselves and who have common interest. You have to bring in Iran, you know, making it an inclusive dialogue. You cannot ignore Iran in any kind of a regional security dialogue that you propose. And I think the experience does tell us that if you don't include Iran, you will be able to achieve something which is sustainable. Focus again has to be on politico-economic cooperation. Any constructive engagement among regional and extra-regional actors will not be possible if, you know, we bring in various actors which do impinge on, you know, the situation, the politics, the security and, you know, economic dimensions of the region and their involvement. And therefore, the role of extra-regional actors cannot be completely ruled out. So model of engagement via regional institution plus is something which can be talked about. And I think I'll stop here when we talk about the region. This was very important for understanding, you know, how the we can see, you know, the Israel-Palestine conflict in today's context. Next slide, please. I think you can skip few of them. These are just the data which I wanted students to understand, because COVID-19 and the region, you know, it has brought about major, you know, shift in terms of, and many new things have unfolded and particularly affecting the economies of these countries. So please come to that Israel-Palestine. We can, what I'm trying to say here is basically you cannot ignore any impact that the COVID-19 has brought about. Has it really reduced the conflict? No, the answer is no. But as far as the capacity of the countries, you know, the government has definitely been affected. Now, to what extent this will have an impact on various war zones and the conflicts, we are still seeing. One trend is very, very visible, that there has been increase in violence. None of the conflict zones have seen any peace in real terms, and things would get further complicated as we see the impact unfolding and how the economy unfolds in coming months and years. So let us look at the Israel-Palestine conflict. I think, Ankit, you did talk about a little bit of the deep-rooted historical issues between this problem. These are what we see unfolding today is the colonial legacy. You know, that is what is very much the reality and the fact on ground. Regional dynamics and the growing military power of Israel is something, and it has been supported by the United States. We heard the Israelis, a very senior official with whom we had a very detailed interaction. They said when Israel was created, they thought, they will have to coexist with the Palestinians in the initial years, because, they never thought that the region will not be united. And in fact, the rest of the Arab world did not, develop in the way that they could be a united front to challenge the Israelis. And therefore, in the initial years, they thought they would coexist. Fortunately for the Israelis, things worked out well for them. They got the full support, the military support from the United States, and they have become the power to reckon with. And therefore, the way they have built, their own country, and despite the fact that this problem has come up in many ways, when we go back to Arafat's time and how PLO, could attract the international attention, and therefore certain pressure on Israel to come on table. But they were, every time, this issue has come up, it has been managed very well, managed in the favor of Israelis because of their full support by the power like United States, and the weak position of the Arab world ununited. And I don't think, they have the Arab world has been put up really a united front in terms of, except for raising and supporting the cause, but in terms of really bringing in a kind of a pressure on Israel to get concessions for the Palestinians, that hasn't worked out. And today, of course, the situation has been very, very different. Then why, this 11-day conflict now? I think this is one question which has often, been raised. And if we see the recent debate, whether it is in the Indian media or, outside, we do see, two factors as to why this has happened. This has happened for two reasons, I would say. Why? I mean, the timing as such. There are many issues and factors that have been talked about, and one of them is the internal political dynamics in Palestine and in Israel. I mean, we have Netanyahu, which is very, very aggressive, strong in terms of trying to project itself to defend its people. And there's no doubt, it's highly securitized state. Now, as far as the Palestinians are concerned, they are not united today. You have Mahmoud Abbas, which is sort of losing its influence, and you have Hamas, which has become very, very strong now. Now, and that is, and there is an Iranian support to it. there are, you know, countries which are supporting Hamas, and despite being a terrorist organization, you know, you can see, you know, that they are trying to attract more attention by using violence. Now, violence is not something which will deliver them the desired result. But today, I mean, if we see this particular conflict, they have achieved some, you know, acceptance in terms of the international community. I mean, you also saw that the Israel-Palestinian conflict, which was on the back burner, not many people were paying much attention to it. But, you know, these 11 days of war and the destruction which it brought to both the countries and more to the Hamas and, you know, to the Gaza. But at the same time, it was able to project itself as a victim because of the huge, you know, military power which the Israel enjoys and it has inflicted on them. So why 11 days conflict now? There are other reasons also, you know, as to what happened, you know, in Jerusalem, in East Jerusalem, and, you know, the Israeli, you know, police and the forces out to sort of limit the Palestinian, you know, in Jerusalem on the day of the Ramadan. Now, so those are the factors, but it is very difficult to completely say that, you know, this is the reason why it, but we do see the, you know, the trends which unfolded in the way which led to it. And there were enough reasons for Netanyahu to prove its credibility, the legitimacy, and that how, you know, he could impress. That is something which is being talked about. And the question as to who gained out of this conflict. So most of the people would say, while the damage was done more to the Hamas and the people in the Gaza, but at the same time, as I said, you know, you see the support for them in the European countries overall, in the international community. So they did succeed in bringing attention back to the Palestinian issue, including the Biden administration, where, you know, they had to address, they had to talk about it. So these are the temporary gains for them. How, you know, situation will unfold, whether the ceasefire is sustainable, that only time will tell. But this is not something new. It has been happening. And I'm kind of, you know, putting my head on block and saying this is not something which is going to stop here, because Hamas is not going to change its course, because so long as there are the regional actors trying to help them, so long as they keep getting the weapons from their friends and allies, these things are not. Will Israel change its course towards the Palestinian cause? I don't think there are signs for now, there is enough pressure from the United States on the Israeli government to find some kind of a viable solution. Are those settlements, going to be stopped? I don't think. I think I'm getting some questions here, but I'll address them at the later stage. So partially I would say the Palestinians did gain the attention which was not given to them. The other issues were much more prominent, but today this has happened. India's stand on the conflict, I will come back and tell you a little more in detail. But in nutshell, in the other slides, I'll explain it in a little more detail. But our approach was balanced, and it also was reflective of our new West Asia policy that we have taken on, the policy of dehyphenation and managing, you know, our interests, securing our strategic and economic interest in the Gulf. And to, could India have reacted in a different way? I think this is something which we can address later. How durable is the ceasefire? I think this is probably a short-term thing for now. I would say that it might be probably a temporary period where they would stick to the ceasefire, but it cannot, according to me, it cannot be a permanent sort of a situation. And this will come up maybe later, but I don't think this is a very permanent ceasefire and a durable one. Is there going to be a major shift on the Israel-Palestine conflict? I think there would be some kind of a reset we can see, but from the Israeli perspective, I don't think there would be much change. And when we talk about the West Bank, how effectively Abbas is going to create a space for himself. But for now, I don't think, we are likely to see a major shift or a paradigm shift. These are few features which would come and go. Next slide, please. So if we have to look at the conflict, let us see when we say, is there a solution to the problem? So it is very important to understand what do the Palestinians want and is it achievable? Nearly, it's a century old Palestinian movement, which has gone through many ups and downs. As I said, it has its own internal dynamics, competition for power and legitimacy. Hamas is trying to get that legitimacy. So there is an internal dynamics also to the problem that we see in Palestine. Main goal of theirs is to have their own free sovereign state. But when we look at Hamas and how they have reflected, their goal, this is where the problem lies. Hamas wants, extermination of Israel, has been openly hostile to the Jewish state. Its charter of 1988, amended in 27, seeks to reject Israel's right to exist. Now, will Hamas change this position? I don't think so. This is completely unacceptable for any dialogue with the Israelis, and that will not happen. I mean, today you have 2 million people who are living in nearly 63 square kilometer Gaza Strip. Now, this is something which is bringing the humanitarian dimension of it, but how Hamas has used, their own people, their women, their children as a shield, is something which is often, debated by the Israelis. They do send the alarm bells to them saying that you have to vacate before they target the area where they feel the Hamas leadership is there. Now, unless there is some kind of a flexibility shown by both sides, I don't think there would be a very reasonable dialogue which could pave the way for some arrangement of a viable solution to this problem. Next, please. What does this mean for India? And I think the most debated issue, when we look at the India statements in the UNSC regarding the present conflict, is something, there have been two viewpoints on this. Some say yes, this is what was the best way which India could, project itself in the UNSC. And I think, if we look at the statements of the India's permanent representative and what he said, it of course is the balanced, nuanced and layered statement that we saw, there in the India statement. It reflects India's geopolitical constraints as well, and address New Delhi's indirect yet, crucial stakes in the West Asian conflict. If anything, it perhaps tilts towards Israel without appearing to do so, contextualizing, Tel Aviv's right to self-defense and contesting Hamas's narrative while seemingly censoring Israel's actions. Now, for India, I think it is very, very crucial to to ensure that, you know, we have seen, you know, a very strong partnership emerging between India and Israel. And for me, you know, if I have to define the strategic partnership between the two countries, I would say that Israel has really been India's real strategic partner, which has helped India in the times of crisis. And we do see Israel as a very, very strong partner for us. Now, this is not going to change. The position of Israel is something which India has to respect. And that is what got reflected. But could we have, you know, changed our stance on Palestine? I don't think. And this is again, you know, reflective of the way this was put across by our permanent representative, where he stated that the violence began in East Jerusalem a week back. This is what was stated. So there was the linkage saying that violence is not an answer to the problem. And the reason which we said is, you know, linking it to the possible eviction process in Sheikh Zarra and Silwan neighborhood in East Jerusalem. So which means that we have stuck to our position of, you know, having a very, very balanced statement that we gave. And the violence in Jerusalem, especially on Hamas al-Zahra Temple Mount during the holy month of Ramadan. So we actually tried to see and be more pragmatic, protecting our own, you know, position on both the issues. So from my point of view, I don't think you could have given a better statement than what we did. Because you cannot, I mean, given our constraints and limitations, we could not have given a better statement than this. Second, next, please. So if we, I'm just trying to, since we said decoding as to how this has impacted on us, India has expressed our deep concern over the violence in Jerusalem, especially on, this is what I've just said. So the cause has very, very, in a very nuanced way, has been explained. India has also urged both sides to refrain from attempts to unilaterally change the existing status quo, including in East Jerusalem and its neighborhood. I think this probably reflects our balanced approach. And this is something which is important to note. Let's also look at, you know, how then India has also, you know, favored in terms of the sensitivity of the Israeli people. And this statement also does reflect that opinion of ours. And if we look at the concluding statement, it very, very clearly says our representative said, "I retreat India's strong support to the just Palestinian cause and its unwavering commitment to this two-state solution." Now, yes, there is a debate on two-state solution. We do hear, next slide, please. We do hear many, you know, debates in India and outside India where, you know, people have talked about various narratives, whether it is a two-state solution or a three-state solution. But I think our position has been the two-state solution, and this is where we have stuck to our position. Please, Ankit, tell me when I have to stop. And now, if we look at India's position vis-a-vis the international community, I do, as I said, you know, why I say India and Israel are strategic partners, these are the few, you know, factors where I would say India is the strategic partner. Israel is India's strategic partner, number one, our historical connect. People may not talk about it, but we do see that connect with them. The trust is there between India and Israel when we talk about it. There is that understanding. The other factor is the political will. And I think all these elements of strategic partnership fit very well with between India and Israel. the political will has been there, you know, when we talk about enhancing our cooperation and increasing our stakes, you know, vis-a-vis our economic or defense cooperation. We have moved much beyond defense cooperation with Israel today. When we talk about the leadership role and the personality factor, there has been a strong connect between the two leaders. As I said, there is a common understanding on strategic matters as far as India and Israel are concerned. Cooperation during the critical times, you know, is something where both the countries have, you know, we do see that implementing between us and the Israelis. The political systems, so all the you know, factors of India-Israel strategic cooperation are very much there, though we use it very loosely, but when we are talking about Israel, there is a real strategic partnership. We could not have supported Hamas, you know, in terms of, although you will find many people in India debating, saying that India needs to take into account the human cost and the aggression of the Israel on Gaza. Having said this, I do feel that the humanitarian cost is something where India can chip in. It could provide more aid to them. But at the same time, you cannot avoid that the way, you know, Hamas has been using the illegal ways of, you know, harming the interest of the other side. That cannot be ignored. Next slide, please. So if we tell me, do I need to talk? Is there time? Because I thought if there is, I could elaborate more on how India is adapting to these new challenges, or I can come back to the questions and then see what India can do in the region. There are the last slides. You could go to that. I can talk about it, and then maybe students. I see a lot of questions popping up, so I don't want to lose time on not answering the question. So I leave it to you completely. Maybe you could come.
Ma'am, I think it's great.
Go ahead with your talk and come back to the questions later on, ma'am. It is a very interesting talk, and a lot of new perspectives are coming up. So we don't want to interrupt your chain of thought.
No, I prepared it because I thought, you know, there is so much to tell about you know, India's engagement. Let me shorten it because there are many slides. So I thought, you know, students need to get the new perspective. How, you know, if we look at India's current, you know, a policy towards the region, I would say, you know, there has been a major change in terms of the acceptance of India's role in the region. And that is the new momentum which I see after 2014. And we have, you know, consciously decided that we would focus more on the Gulf, and that is where our stakes are higher. But at the same time, you know, there is this new dynamism, which is a very comprehensive, you know, approach that present government has adopted. And I think this is one region where I can say with some amount of confidence that India's approach has been, you know, it has brought out many changes in terms of our gains. So a new ACT-West dynamism has gathered momentum, even if we see the practical implementations of our policies. Next, please. You can be a little faster so that I can. Now, if we look at the growing interest in the region, it is very, very clear. You know, the core of its economic and strategic interests, as I said, are free flow of the bilateral trade and investments. Energy security is uncompromising, you know, sort of factor which keeps us engaged with the region, and we cannot. I mean, today our foreign minister is traveling to Kuwait, which is a major source of energy for us. So we cannot ignore these aspects. The expatriate remittances is the reality. You know, there we have many other, you know, debates as to how, you know, COVID-19 would have impacted on us if the, you know, Indian community had to come back. And the there has been reduction in the remittances as well. So, but it remains the key factor for us to stay focused on the Gulf region. The counter-radicalization and combating terrorism is such an important, issue for us. And we have achieved some success in terms of our partnership, whether we are talking about the Gulf states or we are talking about, enhancing our cooperation with the other West Asian countries. Maintaining strong relations with the regional power centers despite the adversarial relations between them. And here we are referring to maintaining our relations with Iran while building the stronger partnerships with UAE and Saudi Arabia. Next, please. These are just the trade figures, so you can be a little faster, Ankit. Now, this shows you the economic dimension of our partnership. So you can very clearly see from the India's trade with the GCC country, which makes it so important for us to ensure that we put more importance to the GCC countries. Next, it's just to show you, please continue while I speak. These are the trade figures and the slides. Stop for a minute so that students can understand. And I've also given you the non-GCC countries in terms of their quantity and figures. So this is something which is a fact which can be seen. Next, please. I don't have to elaborate them here. This is just for the information of the students as to how India has not only been focused on the GCC, but there has been attempt to improve ties with the non-GCC countries as well. That's been the new dynamics with the West Asian countries. Second, next, please. Go on, Ankit. I think there is much. These are, the comparative outlook. If we compare with the GCC, with the non-GCC, you can see the clear difference. And this, why I'm saying this is that I want you to see this difference because I have always recommended that we built the strong ties with the GCC. It is time for us to go beyond it and, develop faster engagements with the other partners, the non-GCC. Next, please. So this is just the percentage term, the quality, the quantity. Go on, Ankit, please. This is just to show visually so that, you can understand why, we need, we have, taken a certain position on the key issues when it comes to the regional geopolitics. Energy security also, if you see Iraq, I'm saying why, when we talk about Palestine, we talk about Israel, look at the GCC and Indian oil imports from GCC plus Iran. This is what it is. Although the Iranian oil, imports have reduced more or less zero, but there is a new attempt to revive it, and I hope it would be done subsequently. Next, please. So this will clearly highlight the energy dimension or the factor of energy which keeps us engaged with it. Next, please. This is the remittances. So if we look at the percentage also, it is very, very crucial, and particularly for the Kerala state. And you can't rule out the fact that this is the key factor for which India needs to have a better plan in future. And that is also the reason why we see, frequent visits from India to these GCC partners, ensuring that, there is a positive response, a greater diplomacy to ensure the security of our people so that there is a continuous flow. Although it has reduced due to the COVID problem, but it is still a very important factor. Next, please. This is the percentage of the migrants. You can see it very clearly tells you what it is. So I just wanted you to give an overall picture so that from the macro to micro, So this gives you a good understanding of why this region remains so significant, and why, you know, if we make a statement even about Israel-Palestine conflict, we have to keep these interests in mind. One can go and argue finding faults, but at the same time, this is the fact which needs to be elaborated. Next, please. These are the figures of the remittances, so which clearly again highlight the argument which I'm putting forth. Next, please. I think these are the key highlights of the politico-strategic cooperation in last 6 years. And we have cemented our ties with UN, Saudi. We have taken the bilateral relationships to the greater height. We have tried to capture every opportunity despite, US sanctions on Iran. So Chabahar is one example. Even if there is a slow movement, I think we have continued. We have given new direction to cooperation with Jordan, Palestine, Oman, Qatar, and reaching out even to Bahrain, and the kind of acceptance which Prime Minister Modi has got in these countries is unmatchable, I would say. So we have also intensified our cooperation with Iraq, from where we get the major energy supplies. So that is one. Next, please. There are some success stories of, certain deals with the Reliance Group when we are talking about the COVID period. I'm not getting into detail because there's some more I would like to highlight. That if there is a time permits, I can come back. These are only details of how the private sector has been able to get some, attention and arrangements despite COVID. Next, please. This is just a detail. If the students are interested, they can use it for their writings and other things. Next, please. How has India responded to these changes? Much I have already said, we moved from look to think to link. And we are today in the mode of Act West Asia dynamism, which is very, very clear. And I said there has been flow of high level visits from both sides. Next, please. I think we have also been able to navigate, our active diplomacy, keeping the sensitivity of the issues in mind. And we have been able to forge a win-win bilateral ties with all our partners in the Gulf and beyond, except for Turkey, where we have had some issues. But I think other than that, we have been more or less successful, whether we talk about Morocco, Tunisia, Egypt. Barring Turkey, I think our diplomacy has been much more successful. Next, please. Move faster so that I can complete. I think this is something which is the hard reality. These are few details. And in nutshell, if I have to summarize, the economic diplomacy and our cooperation in the counterterrorism is something which has been the key factor. The third important dimension, I would say, the which is a key feature, is the military security cooperation, the maritime cooperation, and the visits of the army chiefs to the region. And I think this very clearly reflects our future approach to the region. And we've moved much beyond the buyer-seller relationship when it comes to the energy component of our relationship. And that is where even the investments in the third country is something which is not ruled out. And in future, we are going to see much more aggressive diplomacy, whether we are talking about investment, whether we are talking about joint production, whether we are talking about the partnership in the third country. And this is something the key. Move on, Ankit, please. So these are some of the details only that I, but the point that I want to convey is that there is going to be a forward movement on all aspects with these, and this is what is something which is the situation on ground. I'm not talking, yes, there are some flaws which can be addressed given the economic limitations at the moment, but I'm sure about it, in the long term, there's only going to be a forward movement. Next, please. Go on. I think there's, Ankit, you can move on. Yeah. When we talk about the Arab League also, I think India is very much there. OIC, I think there is every possible effort on part of India to see to it that they are accepted as an important partner, for which we have a strong backers like Saudi Arabia and UAE. There's a debate that we need to extract more. The way Chinese have been able to been very successful in keeping, you know, their Xinjiang region, the Uyghur movement, as you know, they have been able to neutralize that there. So India has to make much more effort. The only OIC meeting where we were able not to bring the Kashmir issue in the debate was in the Astana. That is the only thing that I can remember. But I do see the active diplomacy would subsequently help us in ensuring, you know, that we protect our national interests in these foras through our strong partnership with them. So if we look at the overall, you know, factors, as I said, the Asian countries have common interest. So if we look at the common factors which are impacting all the Asian countries in this part of the world, COVID-19 is, which is impacting every country, I think. Energy security, connectivity, climate change, pandemic, natural disaster, extremism, IS, Al-Qaeda, trade and commerce. So these are some factors. Since there's one narrative that the Asian partners have to come together to work collectively, and this is more in the light or the perception that the US is in the mode of withdrawal. Although I don't believe that the US is going to, it is going to scale down its sort of engagement, but it is not going to go away from the region. And I do feel that the focus is more now on managing, you know, or limiting the Chinese influence. And also they don't see, you know, Russia as a solution. They see Russia as well as a problem. So the global, in the global arena, the changes, you know, would definitely impact this region. While China would be very much, active there, in which it is active, China also offered, you know, to initiate a dialogue in Beijing when it came to the Israel-Palestine conflict. But to what extent China would be willing to really step into United States shoe, I have my doubts. I don't think that is what it means. They are looking at, you know, as I said in the beginning, I think I talked about the great integration game, and this is what the China is playing in every region, and West Asia remains an extremely important region for China's Belt and Road Initiative. And yes, the other important, issue which, you know, does, bring a point of how the new roles, how do we protect the interest of our people, bringing in the new rules which have been very much in formulation in the Gulf countries. This is something which we need to take into account. And I think when you see the increased diplomacy, there are many, new regulations, whether we talk about Kuwait. And I think if you see our foreign minister's visit to Kuwait now, it will be addressing many issues, including, you know, how to protect India's interest and the people who are there in Kuwait. Next, please. These are just few things I thought I'll just highlight. Country-specific rule and India's concern. I mean, these are some details which can be. I would just urge the students to read it, and they can always email me also The remittances, as I said, have also been impacted. These are simply some figures and detail for them to understand. Next, please. What should be the new policy approach? And as I said, we've already focused on the GCC. So this is a time for India to, go into greater expansion, moving in the new directions. And these are the various sectors that we could go in. We can chip in, and basically, you know, we need to have greater focus on Oman, Kuwait, Qatar, Bahrain, Jordan, and Egypt, which the process has already been initiated. And I'm sure in future we would be looking at all these, whether it is IT, whether it is disaster management, the cultural diplomacy, the soft power, the education. This is what it is. Next, please. When we come to our partnership with Israel, then I do think there is a new opening for India, UAE, Israel cooperation, and that the new area, of course, could be the fintech, the finance technology. And this is where I think the future lies for us to cooperate. And the Make in India, to make for world, joint production, jointly working, I think I've talked mostly about them. Next, please. What can India do? I think the first thing which India can do is initiate India-West Asia Dialogue Forum. And when I'm saying this, this is something on the line of the Africa Summit that we have done. And I was told by none other than our former Joint Secretary, Nirvana, that this is something which is under consideration. I hope in the subsequent years we would do it. We could also talk about, this is the way we can engage the region. I mean, talking about how India can chip in, bringing all the actors, you know, not that India has a solution for all the problems and the conflicts, but, you know, it could create a regional center of excellence for countering extremism and terrorism based in any city in India, initiate all religion dialogue, including Sunni scholars from Egypt and from Saudi Arabia and the Shia clerics from the region. So many things are doable. We can also build the West Asian University on the existing line of the South Asian University. There are many, working groups which are already there, and we could push them a little more. Next, please. Sharing our experience is also something which is the future area that we could talk about. Next, please. Training programs, I've already said. The one idea which has often been argued, at least among the strategic community, is starting the dialogue among the Asian partners. And this is where I'm talking about bringing in the Japan, the Koreans, and Indians, and perhaps, maybe in later stage, the Chinese, we don't know. But this is something which is very much, what are options to deal with the new situation in the COVID times? We have to intensify diplomacy, which we've done, joint working groups to be created to address various issues. Training and greater information sharing is required in the states, policy of the state to be reoriented. We need to re-energize the Skill India program, and the new economic plans have to be mapped today. Anytime, this is something, which is an unpredictable situation. So you need to be prepared for future crises, future pandemics, future disaster management. And unless you have a new economic plan in place, things are not going to work for us. I think I'll stop here. And I did see some questions coming on screen. So I would love to answer whatever are there, or if something I've left out in the sense.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think it covered, your presentation covered each and every element and dynamics of the region, and especially India's position in the region. I think we have a lot of questions, ma'am. I think I couldn't see, but we have a lot of questions. First is, I think we have one of our assistant professor, Kanchana. She asked, what sort of an effect on the influence of Iran, if at all, has been the killing of Soleimani and Fakhrizadeh, these nuclear scientists?
Okay, so let me tell you the impact of the killing of Qasem Soleimani and Fakhrizadeh is that the Iran will be much more aggressive. We have to understand the internal dynamics of Iran. Definitely, killing of Soleimani was a major blow to Iranians, and especially the Iranian Revolutionary Guard. I'm not getting into the rightness or the wrongness of it, but the impact which it has had, because people's sentiments were so much attached with that man, and he was an institution in himself. So losing a leader like that definitely had an impact. And you can feel that, you can see that. Unfortunately, you know, in retaliation, there was a misfire, and then, you know, the missile hit the wrong aircraft, the airline, the passenger airlines. And that, I think, you know, changed the whole situation. So today, is IRGC going to be somewhat different in future? I don't think so, because the ideology is so strong there. But economically, yes, I would say there have been much more pressure on the regime to see to it that the people don't come on street. So yes, there has been impact in terms of the structure and the acceptance which General Soleimani enjoyed, and the Americans did succeed in probably destroying that. How the futures, and one of the impact or the reason why you see hardliners, you know, getting more acceptance is this. So the flip side of it is that the killing of Qasem Soleimani has resulted in the hardliners coming back to power in Iran. And I think that is something which is not a very positive impact from the point of view of the international community. But this is how they have reacted to it, because they feel very insecure, and they feel that Iran has to have that leadership role in the Shia community and in the larger Islamic world. Now, that has been the flip side of it. But yes, this is what has been the impact.
Thank you, ma'am. I think there's one more question from one of our students, Nisha. She asks, what is your assessment of Iran's role in attack on Israel? And what is India's position on Hamas as a terrorist organization?
Hello. Yes, actually, the attack, Iranian attack on Israel and Israeli attacks on Iranian ships and the various explosions, this is something which is more like a proxies who are working, you know, for Iran. And what is the strategic asset of Iran? You know, I have always raised this question, that what is it that Iran is such a threat and a challenge to a superpower like United States? They have not been able to deal with Iran. I think the major strength of Iran today is the strategic assets which it has developed over the years. Hamas is willing to die for them. You know, yes, there are problems and issues, you know, within Palestine. They are fighting for their cause. You have Hezbollah, you know, dying for Iran. So these are the strategic assets which they have developed over the years. And other example is that of Yemen, you know, Houthis. So I don't think Iran would, as I said, change its course of action, and particularly in the context of the situation where Iran is being isolated, there are more sanctions on it. This situation will not change now, and therefore you will continue to see, tit for tat activities if the Israelis do, and there have been explosions inside Iran today. which was never the case in past. So yes, there are also some writings which indicate that in the killing of Qasim Soleimani, there were intelligence provided by the Israelis to them. So we do see the role of Israel in ensuring that Iran doesn't become so powerful, it acquires nuclear weapons, and it becomes a major threat, not in terms of only, but through the proxies, how it can. Why do you think the Israel was so active when Qasim Soleimani himself was on ground in Syria? So I think these are the things which will continue, and it is very difficult to point out who did what, but yes, there are some sort of indications to say that this is an attempt by such and such, but it would be difficult to prove it. But there are a few things which can be proved by seeing the missiles which come from Gaza to Israel. They are coming from Iran, and they are very open about it. Now, India's position on Hamas, I think we don't support any act of terrorism. And this is what is going to be our position. We support, Abbas. Even if you see Prime Minister Modi's visit, it is to Ramallah. So for us, it is Ramallah. But if there is also debate that India needs to reconsider, its approach and maybe initiate a talk with Hamas, as, there is an understanding that you have to engage with Taliban as well. So I don't know how the things are going to unfold in future, but definitely India is not for any kind of an engagement with any terrorist organization which indulges into such activities.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. I think before we move ahead with I think other very important question, I think we have Dr. Shekhar Adhikari, who have very two quick points to make on I think the same issue. So over to you, sir. So you are mute.
You are mute, sir.
Please unmute yourself.
He hasn't unmuted.
Sir, please unmute yourself. We are not able to hear you. Okay, by the time he... okay.
Yeah, he has Hello? Unmuted.
Yes, sir, please.
First of all, ma'am, I appreciate your understanding of the regional order of West Asia. Your understanding, and in a very subtle manner, you have put forward the idea to the students of Rashtriya Suraksha University or the Department of Student of the State. But one thing that is confusing me, when you talk of Egypt, do you consider Egypt as a part of West Asia, or is it a part of Middle East? What is the difference between these two regions, Middle East and West Asia? This is my one point. One point, important point you have missed is OPEC. Today, we are facing the oil crisis all over the world, particularly in India. So what, I mean, every day, I mean, every channel and every time, I mean, the opposition, they are crying that fuel prices are so much and so forth. Third important point which I would like to mention is I will focus now on Israel-Palestinian this problem before 1990 and after 1990. Why I say so? Because of the disintegration of the Soviet Union. Before 1990, in the era of Cold War, many points you have covered. Well, military alliances that was there because of the differences between USA and USSR on ideological ground. And in order to check the Russians in Middle East, or where you can say in West Asia, they came with the CENTO. And though in 75 or in mid-75, it was nowhere, but it was an important military alliance. Second important point, which I would like to mention for so far, Israel-Palestine issues concerned, is the Jerusalem. mean, you should have mentioned the Balfour Declaration. That was the main cause of this dispute between this thing, between Israel and Palestinian people. Because there, Jerusalem for Palestinian is a land where not only Muslims, but Christians and Jews reside. But to the Israeli, Jerusalem is the eternal capital of Israeli state. So what about the conflict point of conflict point is here is how we look at other communities. Here in India also we have diversity in culture, in religion, but we stand as a nation at one. But here in the Arab world, I mean, I am giving you the one example, how they stand, how you can procure peace and stability when everything is based on military security. Palestine, I mean, one of my researchers was a Palestinian student. I mean, when I talked to him about the economic cooperation, he talked only about military security of Palestine because they want to defend their own territory. I mean, they are interested in defending their own territory. The threat is from Israel. So here, economic development is good, of course. I mean, they are dependent, Palestine is dependent on European countries. And more important is the Russian role. Well, no, not the Russian, but American role. I mean, in America, there's a powerful lobby, Jews lobby. Will you think that Jews lobby will, just 1 minute, will the Jews lobby will permit that the solution will be solved, whether they will accept Palestinian organization as a, it is a PLO, as an independent state, will this Israel state will permit this, or will India, what kind of role India will play in the formation of Palestine as an independent state, keeping in view we have a very balanced this thing kind of relation between USA and USSR at the moment, though China is not there. China had their own problem just to contain the Americans' influence in West Asia. That is why they are in Iran. So these are some of my observations, and these are some of the points which, though it was a very elaborative, though I could have continued more, but because I want to give more, I mean, this thing to other people and other students.
Thank you so much, sir.
Can I just respond?
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Well, you're very right when you talk about Jerusalem. Let me start with the Jerusalem, the last issue that you talked about. Maybe I might, it might, because that is the core issue, right? And I don't think there is any solution to it, the problem, unless, as some people have said, can Jerusalem be the Vatican of Israelis and the Arab world and the Christianity? So if all three community agree to give that independent status to Jerusalem, which is the only way, unless the three major, you know, religion, and they see that in that. So I don't see anybody giving up their claims as far as Jerusalem is concerned. But the only way that, you know, some of our strategic thinkers do talk about making it, will it become a Vatican? So that is the question mark. If it does, then maybe there is some way to accept it. Will the Israelis accept such a situation? I don't think, given the strength, the military strength, you've already talked about the asymmetric, you know, sort of situation between the Palestinians and the Israelis. And I think, you know, this is one factor where, you know, the international community has been very, very supportive of the Palestinian cause. But at the same time, there are also concerns of the extremist elements which are, you know, finding their own space in, for example, in Hamas. Now, how do you deal with that situation? Would you like to provide military, you know, equipments to these hidden extremist groups? I don't know. I don't have an answer for this. Can you do that? But if it comes to supporting the West Bank, strengthening, you know, their institutions, providing them, and we as an Indian, I don't think we have ever. I think the people in the defense would be a better sort of people to say. But from my own understanding, we have not been the arms exporting countries. We have been mainly, you know, providing the training and help. That is one. On the Jerusalem, yes, I should have made mention to the Balfour Declaration. Maybe this is something which is pretty known. On the role of Russia, I think the Russians are very carefully crafting their approach. When it comes to Israel, there are enough Russian Jews there, and Russia doesn't want to lose out, you know, their strong engagement with the Israelis, and this will continue. So some kind of a balance is something which will go. Russians would never, if you see their position even on Syria and what the Israelis want, there have been major visits to and fro, and so are the Chinese. We look at the Chinese investments in Israel. You know, look at their engagement with Israel. It is far more than what is our engagement in terms of investments and how they have infiltrated in their IT sector. So I don't see that whether it is China or Russia or United States, you know, which is going to be completely siding with the Palestinians against Israelis, that situation I don't think will happen. But some ways to ensure the kind of a political process which will dilute the negative impact and, you know, of the conflicts like this can be managed in a better way. How should India play a role in formulating, you know, independent sovereign state? Of, I think at this point in time, we need not get into these issues, because you will get sucked into a kind of the politics where your own national interest needs to be protected first. You have to invest more where, you know, you have more stakes. This is not to deny that you stop speaking. We should speak for them. We should provide them required help and aid. But the military dimension and military aid is something which I personally am not very positive about it, or which is not very acceptable, because military engagement or military supplies could be, it's a double-edged weapon, and I think it can be played both ways. On the oil prices, I think we will continue to see, because the entire energy scenario has changed in the today's context. I don't think I had enough time to explain the new energy game which you can see. So there are new elements in the energy game today which we see. Yes, we need oil, but look at the climate change issue. Look at how we are shifting, you know, from oil to the other resources. So that will decide, and how US, now OPEC is one, they would try and protect their interests, and that is what will happen. But there would be many fissures also, I mean, when we talk about this. So prices will be, you know, fluctuating, and they have fluctuated in past also. As far as the Indian situation is concerned, I think it is for the government to take a call as to how best they can provide the best possible way to address this issue, not, you know, hurting our economy. That is one. On the nomenclatures, Egypt is a part of North Africa. That's a well-established. But, you know, in India, when we look at our Ministry of External Affairs also, we normally use West Asia. And when we say West Asia and North Africa, that is where Egypt is part of it. But we have clubbed Iran, for example, with Afghanistan and Pakistan. But in an overall this thing, if we use Middle East and these, but, you know, it is not Middle East for us when we look at that region. For us, it is West Asia and North Africa. So I put Egypt as a part of West Asia and North Africa. I think I have sort of clarified. I hope I have addressed some of.
I think, ma'am, we have one of the, I think we have a lot of questions, but due to short of time, I'll pick up a few very interesting ones. I think this is from one of our students, Isha. I think she asked, do you think the regional as well as the extra-regional powers are willing to prolong the conflict to serve their respective interests?
The simple answer is yes. But it is not so simple also, because the interests of the regional and extra-regional actors are continuously changing. For example, did we ever think that the Israel would be accepted, partner of UAE and Bahrain? No, I don't think anybody thought about it. But the US, kind of weakening position, its internal economic, capabilities have reduced. The increasing Chinese role in the region has brought about this. So there are going to be constant changes in the regional and the extra-regional players. And as I also said, so long as the economic part of it remains stronger, and there are other dimensions of the conflict. Now, I never mentioned about the arms lobby. You know, I think the arms lobbies of regional and extra-regional players will play a very, very significant role, because who are they going to sell arms to if the conflicts are not there? While there are ideological underpinnings, while there are regional geopolitical issues, there are economic issues, but there are global issues as well. And the bottom line, of course, has always been the economics, the resources, and how do you exploit them? The bigger power will continue to exploit that in favor of their own interest.
Yes, ma'am. And I think the other question is, ma'am, from Divya. She asked, do you think Benjamin Netanyahu's political ambition were a factor in inciting violence this time? And in addition to that, she asked, is Israel-Palestine process likely to make any progress under the Biden administration?
Divya, Netanyahu, yes, I think he wanted to showcase himself in many ways. He wanted more legitimacy in that sense. But, you know, I don't have a very definitive answers. There were reasons from both sides which instigated in many ways the violence. As I said, you know, this is not the first time that something like this has happened. There has been a continuous process of the conflict, which, what is the trigger point? Could we really blame it on Netanyahu? I mean, maybe now the internal political situation within Israel was such that people could put the blame on that, saying, look, there are internal issues and therefore he was trying to acquire more legitimacy and therefore this happened. But I think without that also, there could have been a situation like this. And the second part was, will the Palestinian issue be resolved, you said, or will get it more attention? I think resolving the Palestinian issue is, I'm not very optimistic about it. Maybe the better management, but I think under Biden administration, there would be some more effort on their part to address the Palestinian issue as compared to the previous regime. That's what it would be.
Ma'am, just the last question. Sumana asked, she's assistant professor with us. She asked, there is an ongoing narrative that the Israeli regime, which believes and maintaining a privileged position for the Jew while presenting Israel as a democratic country, is on its way to demise, as it is not feasible to sustain a paradoxical framework. Do you concur with this narrative? And is there any possibility of some change in this discourse?
You see, the fact that Israel is a democracy is the fact. Let me tell you, having lived there for many months, I had a very different perception about Israel. But when it comes to if it was not democracy, I think you would have you would not have had so many elections in last year. Otherwise, things would have been very different. So it is a democracy. Yes, they have seen, But when we talk about the Arab Jews, you know, Arabs living in Israel, you know, things could be taken in a different direction. Do they have enough? They are better off, but do they have the same rights as the Jews? I would have my reservations on that, you know. But they are definitely, and they haven't, only this time we saw, uprising, within the Arabs living in Israel as well. But it is a democracy. Let us accept the hard reality, which is actually happening. Otherwise, you know, you could have only seen if there was no democracy, then somebody, you know, Netanyahu could have continued again. But that's not what it is.
Thank you so much, ma'am. I think we close the question answer session here. It was really interesting, ma'am, to listen to you. You're such an insightful presentation. Your expertise about the region and question, and especially thanks to our participants who asked really important question, pertinent question on this. With this, we come to the end of this session. And I think I would like to thank you, ma'am, on behalf of Director Smastel, as well as Rashtriya Raksha University, to give a lecture on this subject. And in the end, I would like to thank all those who have joined us from different parts. We have students, our own students, as well as few from think tanks, as well as different university. Thank you so much. Thank you so much all for joining us. We'll meet again next Wednesday with a new theme and with a new speaker. Thank you so much, ma'am.
It is a pleasure, and I hope, you know, I made some sort of some kind of an understanding which I have. I've tried to share it. I don't think, you know, anybody can claim to have an authority on understanding that region. Is such that, you know, every day you are learning about the region. So I am still learning about that region. I can't claim that I'm an expert, but I think there's a continuous process of learning, and it's something which we would continue to put our effort and share what we understand from it.
I'm sure, ma'am. I think like scholars like me have grown reading your work. And many others like you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Director, I think Colonel Joshi, if you would like to make any closing remarks.
First of all, I'm very thankful to ma'am and a very deep understanding of the region, which is not an easy region, firstly, because it has got so many dimensions to it, political, religious, security, and all kind of angles are there. But you very succinctly told us how and what is India's position, number one, and what could be one of those solutions which you have mentioned, which was very well this thing that it becomes the Vatican of the Middle East or something like that. But it requires to play up with your own domestic audience also, which when the tempers are high and a lot of bloodshed has been made, it will not be very easy transition. But nevertheless, history is a very, any possibilities are there. And if people are sensible and they move towards the right direction, that could be done. So we are very thankful to you, ma'am, and that very complex region which is there, and a lot of sentiments here in India and elsewhere, which you have charted very well and kept out of all kinds of controversies, all kinds of things which are there, and told the facts they are. So that way, we are very, very thankful to you, ma'am. And it was very well listening.
It's pleasure for students always.
Students also then had a lot of questions, and since their understanding of diplomacy and politics and international relationship is just their starting on it, they have to be patient, because this is a long game, and things do not happen overnight, and a lot of parlance takes place, backdoor diplomacy, a lot of things are there. So that was a very good, I think, for our students also, and for our faculty also, we got a new perspective, and there were very pointed questions also. I'm very happy that you took them very well and in your stride, ma'am. That was good. So thank you very much from Smastel's side.
Pleasure.
Thank you. We will keep in touch and always welcome on speaking on such subjects.
Thank you so much, sir.
From my school side, thanks.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you, ma'am, and thank you all of those who have joined us. We'll meet next Wednesday. Thank you so much for joining. Stay safe.
Thank you. All of you stay safe and look after yourself.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, Divya, for bringing me in. So, thanks.
Thank you.
All the best to all of you.
Thank you.
Okay, Ankit and Divya, all the best. Write more and, you know, tell your students to read more. Try and develop a good library, digital and otherwise.
Yeah, right, ma'am. As I think General Gurmeet Brigadier Kanwal used to say, publish or perish. I think that's...
Yes. You will not perish because you will publish.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.